West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy with Chef Justice Putnam. NetRootsRadio.com.
Je voudrais du soleil vert, des dentelles et des théières, des photos de bord de mer, dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je voudrais de la lumière, comme en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Je veux changer d'atmosphère, dans mon jardin d'hiver.
Well, tonight, Donald Trump is blaming Mike Pence for the Trump mob's violent attack on the Capitol on January 6th. Yes, you heard right. Donald Trump is blaming the guy who the Trump mob said they wanted to hang. Donald Trump's blaming him for the mob who wanted to hang him on January 6th. What Donald Trump said about Mike Pence today will be Exhibit A at Donald Trump's trial if he is charged with crimes about January 6th, according to our first guest tonight, former federal prosecutor Andrew Weiss. Donald Trump was responding today to comments made by Mike Pence on Saturday night in Washington at the most formal event that occurs in Washington and has been occurring in Washington annually for 138 years, the Gridiron Dinner. It is one of those ultra cozy events hosted by prominent members of the Washington Press Corps who do not allow press coverage of their own event, of course, in which the women always wear evening gowns and the men are required to dress not like it's the Oscars, not in black tie, because that's not formal enough, good enough for the Oscars, but not the Gridiron Dinner. Black tie is not good enough. The men have to dress in white tie and tails. Our account of the Gridiron Dinner tonight will, of course, come from our favorite Washington guest who always has his white tie and tails costume hanging in the closet and ready to go, Neil Katyal, who was there Saturday night when Mike Pence, in what no doubt passed for bravery in Mike Pence's mind, said in a room where cameras and recording devices were banned, history will hold Donald Trump accountable. Mike Pence was talking about the January 6th attack on the Capitol. Mike Pence said, tourists don't injure 140 police officers by sightseeing. Tourists don't break down doors to get to the Speaker of the House or voice threats against public officials. And here is the line that Mike Pence probably plans to use someday on the Republican primary debate stage in his losing presidential campaign against Donald Trump. Mike Pence said, President Trump was wrong. I had no right to overturn the election, and his reckless words endangered my family and everyone at the Capitol that day, and I know that history will hold Donald Trump accountable. Mike Pence does not apparently care that a federal grand jury is trying to hold Donald Trump accountable right now for what happened on January 6th, and would like Mike Pence's testimony to help them decide who should be held accountable. But Mike Pence is refusing to testify to that grand jury because he is Mike Pence, a name that will always be synonymous with the most astonishing, duplicitous weakness on display in Washington in the first quarter of the 21st century. When a Washington Post reporter asked Donald Trump for his reaction to Mike Pence's comments today, Donald Trump said, had he sent the votes back to the legislatures, they wouldn't have had a problem with January 6th. So in many ways, you can blame him for January 6th. Had he sent them back to Pennsylvania, Georgia, Arizona, the states, I believe, number one, you would have had a different outcome, but I also believe you wouldn't have had January 6th, as we call it. The Trump mob was attacking the Capitol before the first challenge was made to the Electoral College vote count on January 6th. Donald Trump not unreasonably sees Mike Pence's change of tone about him as simply a presidential campaign choice. The Washington Post quotes Donald Trump saying, I guess he figured that being nice is not working, but you know, he's out there campaigning and he's trying very hard and he's a nice man. I've known him. I had a very good relationship. Until the end. The end of that relationship for Donald Trump came on the phone on January 6th when Mike Pence told Donald Trump once again that he was not empowered by the Constitution with any discretion about how to process electoral votes on January 6th. Donald Trump's last word to Mike Pence was wimp.
I remember hearing the word wimp. Either he called him a wimp. I don't remember if he said, you are a wimp, you'll be a wimp. Wimp is the word I remember.
In Defendant Trump news, we can report to you with absolute certainty that the Manhattan District Attorney will not indict Donald Trump tomorrow or the next day. After that, your guess is as good as mine. Donald Trump's former hush money broker, Michael Cohen, testified to a Manhattan grand jury today about the hush money that he paid to actress Stephanie Clifford, also known as Stormy Daniels, in the final weeks of the 2016 presidential campaign to purchase her silence about the night that she says she had sex with Donald Trump in a hotel room very briefly, 4 months after Donald Trump's current wife gave birth to Donald Trump's youngest child. Michael Cohen's attorney, Lanny Davis, said this.
Michael has spent a long and productive afternoon. I'll speak for him today, answering all questions, all facts, and completely responsive. He's coming back on Wednesday at approximately 1:30 or 2 o'clock to complete his testimony. We're not going to make any comments about what he said other than to repeat what Michael has said. This is about accountability, and this is about facts and the truth, period. The presumption of innocence, if anything happens, prevails and applies, and we're happy to cooperate.
So, with Michael Cohen returning to the grand jury on Wednesday, that gives us the absolute certainty that Donald Trump will not be indicted until at least Thursday, if he is to be indicted at all in that case. The Manhattan District Attorney offered Donald Trump a chance to testify to that same grand jury himself, something that is a standard offer from New York District Attorneys to criminal targets who face the possibility of indictment by that same grand jury. Donald Trump's lawyer in the case said this morning that Donald Trump refused the opportunity to testify under oath to the Manhattan grand jury. So, at this point, the only way Donald Trump is going to enter the courthouse in Manhattan on this case is if he has to appear for the first time in his life as criminal defendant Trump.
It is Tuesday, the 14th of March of 2023, and you are in West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. I am your chef de cuisine, Justice Putnam. Gunner, the English Bulldog, is our snoozing sous chef. And our daily special is Tarrytown Chowder Tuesdays, a small, scant dash. A mere pinch of hot smoked Hungarian paprika will make all the difference in the world. You know it always has, and it always will. It will. Okay, had a bit of an issue last night putting the show notes and links diary together because as I was finishing up and putting in the last bits of links, Deco's Daily Co's got glitchy. And so I was uncertain whether I'd even be able to open a diary in the morning. Well, I was, but it's been glitchy all day, so we feel like we're a tad behind here in the royal we, and that would be me, because we've been scrambling. But we'll still be able to put a show together intermittently, or as the Daily Coast site is, intermittent. But nonetheless, how are you? I was unable to catch up on any of the latest up-to-the-minute news as I was working to, get the show notes and links up so that I could, you know, remember what it was that we were doing today. I suppose I should hide them somewhere else, too. Anyway, the bank collapse continues apace. Yesterday was quite a sight to behold in terms of what I'm getting on my timeline on Musk's social media platform. Whereas before he took over, I had a wide array of folks that were in my timeline that I followed and followed me back. And now I get mostly the GOP and worse. And when I say worse, I mean we're talking almost Stormfront, Atomvossen worse. But it's okay. Apparently that's free speech. They're free for the speech, and you're not free to escape from it, because if you do, you're the racist. Oh, okay. I see what you mean. We can't allow these people we've been bullying to get away with us not being able to bully them. They're bullies if they try to bully us. That's what we have to put up with. So, okay. That's what we gotta put up with. What are we gonna do? Well, I don't know. Some people might want to just check out. I don't think that's really an option. Because even checking out, that's not far enough. They'll catch up with you no matter where you've checked out to. Yeah, you know, that old Lutheran minister. Was he Lutheran? You know, the one that said they came for the gypsies, but I wasn't a gypsy. And so that's the terminology, the nomenclature they used. But he wasn't a Roman, so he didn't do anything and went through a whole list of people and groups. And when they finally got to him, there was no one left. And some people like that. They think, well, I'm the rugged individual. I'll take on the whole nation state. Oh, will you? Okay. This ain't a game. You're not going to be able to regenerate yourself. I don't know. Maybe you will. Jeez. In the multi-universe, maybe that's the case. Well, if that's the case, can you put me on the time bubble where we don't have all these Nazis? It's really getting burdensome. Had a news read about the takeover of Democratic cities by Republican legislatures. And guess who's pushing that one? Yeah, Ron DeSantis. Now, I read a little bit about DeSantis and his little wife. You know, the one that set up some sort of disaster relief fund that's independent of the state, but advertised like it was part of the state. And she's been reaping in, I don't know, lots and lots and lots of money. And it hasn't been accounted for. Who does that? Well, it turns out, now, I haven't done my due diligence because I ran out of time, but it sounds right. Anyway, apparently, she comes from, some mob families. And apparently, DeSantis is affiliated, his family is, a part of the extended Lucchese crime family. So is it starting to make sense now? The whole idea of the jut jaw, you know what I'm talking about. You know, you can't have a moo without the Cellini. I don't know what it is about these guys. I think Mussolini was the one. Oh, I'm going to bottle everything around him. You know, from the Mussolini scowl. Trump did the jut jaw pretty good. He still does it. Puts that jaw out there. I'm a rabbit. Yes, right. I'm your commandant. Yeah, your commandant. Yeah. Okay. Commandant. That's what I'm trying to say. I need more coffee. Don't we all? Now, I'm going to be really angry if the oil companies made it so that we don't get our coffee. They knew. They knew back in the 70s that this could happen, and they don't care. I guess they think that they've got enough coffee, well, shitty coffee, stocked up. Assholes. Don't come between me and my coffee. I'm telling you, chicory doesn't work. I've tried it. It's not good enough. Where's the caffeine? I know. What they're going to do is they're going to synthesize it some way. Well, you know, all the alkaloids are right there in my coffee beans. Don't mess around with them. Too late, huh? Yeah, it's too late. Well, we do have a bit of a news read, and though we are behind, I probably should give you a rundown on what we have in store for you so we can get into it. And that would be, well, yeah, Lawrence at the top says that Trump blames Mike Pence for the crowd that chanted, "Hang Mike Pence." And it's not just Lawrence saying it. It's actually Trump blaming Mike Pence for the mob. The mob that chanted, "Hang Mike Pence." That's what it was. On the rest of the menu here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, Tarrytown Chowder Tuesdays. FBI data shows hate crimes had another alarming rise in 2021. More than what it was in 2020. DeSantis is darkening Florida's sunny open records laws. It's all part of a plan, you know. And, you know, Signature Bank is not only, you know, one of the few banks. In fact, I think it just is the only bank that would take a deposit from Trump. Huh, interesting. Well, their collapse spells trouble for the cryptocurrency industry. You know, this whole cryptocurrency thing is to pretty much collapse governments. It's all part of a plan. Do not trust Peter Thiel. Let that be a motto. After the break, we move to the chef's table where Volkswagen is set to build an electric vehicle battery plant in Canada. I wonder why they're not doing it here. Let me guess. And the U.S. is turning to new ways to punish Russian oligarchs for the war. But they don't worry about it because they figure either DeSantis or Trump will be back in office and they can, you know, they don't have to worry about it. We'll see about that. All that and more on West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bon appetit. To the right of the page is the chat room link, and the chat room is monitored by Kelly Lincoln. Thank you, Kelly. Across the page and a little bit down from the chat room link there at the, near the bottom of our homepage at networksradio.com is the link to our Patreon page. And if you could become a recurring Patreon of Netroots Radio, and if you could afford to send us what you might spend on, I don't know, how about an espresso-type coffee drink? If you could afford to send those funds to us once a month, it really does help us pay our bills and continue this powerhouse of resistance that has been resisting. We're having a birthday in just a couple of days, by the way. 1 dozen years. 1 dozen. Yeah. Jeez. Goes by. Went by so fast. Anyway, thank you for your generosity in allowing us to fulfill our civic duty as the founders originally intended so many years ago. If you would like to follow Netroots Radio on Twitter, Mastodon, and Spoutable, you can do so at Netroots Radio. Tom takes care of that and a hell of a lot more. Thank you, Tom. Follow me on Twitter, Mastodon, and Spoutable at Justice Putnam. I post the show notes and links diary, and I assure you that's a very strong place setting in which to put the show notes and links. And that gets posted 10 minutes before showtime. We'll see if that happens today. Might have to manually do it if I can. But anyway, the show notes and links are where you can find the actual reportage, the actual articles from which we are drawing such inspiration from. So go there. You can also follow the show on Twitter, such as it is at Cookbook West. I need to get back in there. It's a different passcode, and I have to like get in there and open it up, and sometimes I forget which Twitter account I'm in. So I need to update that. But nonetheless, you can follow at least, you know, nice pictures of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy at Cookbook West on Twitter. And please do pick up podcasts by way of Spreaker, Stitcher, TuneIn, iHeart, YouTube, iTunes, etc., etc., etc. Okay, this first offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy is Out of the Associated Press by Lindsay Whitehurst. The number of crimes in the U.S. jumped again in 2021, continuing an alarming rise. According to FBI data released yesterday, Monday, nearly 12% increase marks, or the nearly 12% increase marks a reversal of a previous incomplete report from the agency that appeared to show a drop, but was missing data from some of the nation's largest cities, including New York and Los Angeles, you know, where most of the anti-Semite crimes have been committed recently. The hate crime numbers now include those other large departments, and the total is the highest level in decades. Brian Levin, the director of the Center for the Study of Hate and Extremism at the California State University San Bernardino, said, "We are in a unique and disturbing era where hate crimes overall stay elevated for longer." And then punctuated by broken records, he said. Most of the victims, 64.5%, were targeted due to their race, ethnicity, or ancestry. Another 16% were targeted over their sexual orientation, and 14% of cases involved religious bias. And that doesn't mean that all those Christians are having religious bias against them. It's something completely different, and we know what it is. Intimidation and assault made up the largest portion of cases, and 18 murders were also reported to be hate crimes. Half of the religion cases targeted Jewish people, a finding that comes amid rising anti-Semitism, said Jill Garvey, chief of staff at the Western States Center. Monday's report also underscores the need for better record keeping. We're still not getting enough data to know what the extent of the problem is, Garvey said. The data shortfall in the previous report released in December was largely due to changes in how police must report their data back to the FBI to ensure a more complete picture. Agency officials went back and allowed large departments to report under the previous system. Oh, did you? Hate crimes and devastation they cause communities have no place in this country. The Justice Department is committed to every tool and resource at our disposal to combat bias-motivated violence in all its forms, said Associate AG Vanita Gupta.
A. Lee,
of the Associated Press brings us this next offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, Tarrytown Chowder Tuesdays. Florida has long been known for sunshine, not only the warm rays that brighten its beaches, but also the light of public scrutiny afforded by some of the nation's strongest meetings and records laws. Although years of rollbacks have gradually clouded the impact, advocates are ringing alarms that this year presents the greatest threat to transparency yet in the state that coined the name Sunshine Law for its open government rules. Ron DeSantis, weighing a presidential bid, is pursuing a home state agenda that could make it harder for people to learn what public officials are doing or to speak out against them in an unprecedented move for the Sunshine State. DeSantis has claimed an executive right to keep key government records secret. He's also seeking to weaken a nearly 60-year-old national legal precedent protecting journalists and others who publish critical comments about public figures. Florida's Republican-led legislature appears eager to carry out his vision. As their annual session began last week, lawmakers filed dozens of bills that would add to the state's lengthy list of open government exceptions. The state of sunshine is in peril, warned Barbara Peterson, executive director of the Florida Center for Government Accountability, who has been tracking the state's public access laws for 3 decades. DeSantis, who is expected to launch a presidential bid following the session, has thrilled conservative activists nationwide by leaning into fights against the GOP's perceived political adversaries, public health officials, so-called woke leaders in business and public education, and the press. Sounds like the Nazis. Sounds like the fascists, doesn't it? In this reporter's opinion, not that one, this one. Back to that one. Former President Donald Trump, I hate saying the P word, but there you go, a potential rival and fellow Floridian, also was well known for lambasting the press. Really? I wouldn't have known that. But such criticism often plays well within the modern-day Republican Party, where mainstream media are perceived to side with the interests of Democrats and liberals, but it runs contrary to Florida's historic reputation as a place where reporters and curious members of the public can unearth government data and documents that shed light on the decisions made by elected officials. Florida's law making government records open to public inspection dates to 1909, long before similar measures emerged in other states. It added a sunshine law requiring public meetings in 1967. Then in 1992, Florida voters approved a constitutional amendment guaranteeing a public right to access records and meetings. A decade later, as lawmakers were adding exemptions, voters approved another constitutional amendment, making it harder for legislators to approve future exemptions. Florida newspapers launched the first Sunshine Sunday in 2002 to highlight the importance of public access to government information. That one-day event has since grown to an annual Sunshine Week, observed nationally by media and First Amendment advocates. Oh, it's so woke. As this year's Sunshine Week began on Sunday, lawmakers and state capitals were pursuing a mixture of proposals, some excluding more government records from public inspection, others increasing the ability of people to keep an eye on their government. But nowhere, perhaps, have Sunshine Week issues garnered as much attention as in Florida, due largely to DeSantis's powerful platform to voice his complaints about the media. Last month, DeSantis hosted a live-streamed panel discussion on defamation while attempting to build support for his plan to make it easier to bring defamation lawsuits against the media or people who post things on the internet about public officials and employees. DeSantis is seeking to undercut a 1964 U.S. Supreme Court decision that shielded news outlets from libel judgments unless proven that they were published with actual malice. You know, knowing that something was false or acting with reckless disregard to whether it was true. Florida legislation to carry out DeSantis's plan would make it unnecessary to prove actual malice when the allegedly defamatory statements don't relate to the reason why someone is a public figure. Verma and Jacob Bogich of The Washington Post brings us this final offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Signature Bank, a New York-based financial institution with deep ties to the cryptocurrency industry, collapsed over the weekend after depositors made a run on the bank, further roiling the digital assets industry, which has suffered a string of major blows in recent months. The bank has long been an integral financial institution for the industry, hosting tools for facilitating digital transactions and counting notable crypto companies such as the cryptocurrency exchange Coinbase as its clients. It's part of a slim group of mainstream banks catering to the needs of cryptocurrency firms and their clients, an area that was upended after the closing of another crypto-friendly bank, Silvergate Capital, last Wednesday. Signature Bank's collapse was triggered in part by the fall of Silicon Valley Bank, another financial institution interwoven into the fabric of the technology industry, New York Governor Kathy Hochul told reporters in a news conference yesterday, Monday. Few banks were as deeply embedded with the cryptocurrency firms as Signature and Silvergate, and their downfall is a symbolic and practical blow to the embattled industry, legal experts said. The institutions offered an air of legitimacy to crypto companies and provided clients key services, such as around-the-clock transactions. As choice institutions fall, crypto companies may be forced to rethink their financial holdings, driving them into alternative, often riskier banking options, experts added. It's very dark days at present for crypto, said Yoshida Yadav, who studies digital financial regulation and is an associate dean at Vanderbilt University Law School. The big danger here is that folks decide to go offshore, where regulators are having a much harder time monitoring. Greg D. Carmichael, the new chief executive of Signature Bank, said in a press release this morning that bank operations are stable after regulators took over the bank. Our clients' deposits are not at risk, he said. Well, yeah, that's because the feds took it over. All right, let us now go to our break. And when we get back from that break, we will go through weather from around the world. And we will finish up with the stories that we have curated for you today. You are listening to West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. And we will be right back.
You are listening to NetRootsRadio.com.
Please hang up and try again.
From a point at sea to the circles of your mind, a new force is at work for planetary transformation. New radio for a new earth.
It's Pi Day. This is Scientific American Science Quickly. I'm Jeff Delvisio. Well, another 3.14159265358979323846. You get the idea. Day is upon us. It's that special day in March when we collectively celebrate the irrational number represented by the Greek symbol pi. In its simplest definition, pi is the ratio of a circle's circumference to its diameter. Pi shows up everywhere in mathematics. In 1960, our illustrious then-mathematical games columnist Martin Gardner quoted mathematician Augustus De Morgan speaking of pi as this mysterious 3.14159, which comes in at every door and window and down every chimney. Pi shows up outside of its circular home in the motions of springs and pendulums, in probability, and in our 365-day calendar. It shows up in nature everywhere. There's a circle or a spiral, like in planets and DNA. Pi even shows up in the bends of rivers, relating to their sinuosity specifically. The existence of pi has also led to mass baking on March 14th and to pizza discounts. Humans have known about the existence of pi for at least the last 4,000 years. But in the last few hundred years, we have been trying to increase the precision of our calculations of the digits of pi. In 1949, the electronic computer ENIAC was used for 70 machine hours to calculate pi to more than 2,000 decimals. Just last year, Google Cloud calculated it to 100 trillion digits. And along with the race to calculate pi has come a parallel contest of trying to memorize its unending string. Today on Science Quickly, we talk to someone who's created another way to honor and to try to remember the digits of pi, through song. Devin Powell is a science writer and a creator of science multimedia, and he joins us today.
Thanks, Jeff.
So humans have managed to memorize incredibly long sequences of pi decimals. How did you get interested in doing this a different way?
Yeah, so a few years ago, I was challenged to one of these pi digit memorizing competitions. Nothing like the world records. You know, we were trying to get to 50 digits. And a few years prior to that, I had covered the World Memory Championships as a reporter, and I had watched someone memorize a randomly shuffled deck of cards in less than 19 seconds, and spent a lot of time talking to people about how did they pull off these seemingly impossible feats of memory, and learned that it boiled down to not some kind of genetic predisposition to having a great memory or anything like that, but just some tricks where you use associations and you associate one thing with another. So as I approached this pi memorizing competition, I thought, well, what would I associate these digits with that would be meaningful for me? And like many children who sang in choir when they were young, I learned to sing on numbers. It's kind of like the do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do from The Sound of Music.
Happen to be do, re, mi.
Do, re, mi.
Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti. Oh, let's see if I can make it easier.
But 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and up the scale. And so as I started to sit down with these digits, I started to map them onto the notes of the scale. 1 to 1, 2 to 2, up the scale.
And as you started to do that, did it sort of make sense intuitively, immediately, as you started to go through the digits? What did it sound like?
Yeah, so at first this was just a trick for remembering it, right? I was going to have these tones in my head that was going to help me kind of recite these digits. But as I mapped just the very first five digits, it sounded really nice. It sounded like kind of some of the folk songs I used to sing in choir, maybe a lullaby. And had this nice sort of, I'm going to try to sing it here, forgive me.
Give it a shot.
Yeah. I'll give it a shot. Something like 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, kind of walking up the scale. And so I sat down at the piano and started to play with that.
And so as you sat at the piano, did it continue to make sense? You know, it's not a random number, but did it sound like there was something coming together here that was a little bit more than just a seemingly random set of numbers you had to try to internalize?
Yeah, so the fun thing is, if you talk to people who memorize pi, I've actually heard this from other people too who have used other techniques, you find these patterns when you're memorizing it. They're not anything inherent to the mathematics. It's just your brain kind of picking up on stuff. Because I was kind of plinking this out on the piano, I started to identify these phrases that sounded really nice. So that was sort of the starting point of playing with that. I tried parts in a major key, parts in a minor key, playing with different arrangements of chunks from pi.
So what did you end up calling your composition?
It's a little cheesy, but I ended up calling it Lullapie. And actually, one person who helped me a little bit to write this has already used it as a lullaby for his child. So that was really nice.
Did it do the job? Did it put the kid to sleep?
He says she liked it.
Oh, fantastic. So maybe, you know, the next thing, just getting it on the Spotify rotation.
Yeah, I assume it's going to go, you know, double platinum. It's going to, Beyonce is going to cover it. It's going to be fantastic. But I'm actually looking, I'm thinking about maybe orchestrating it with strings, with flutes, trying to kind of play around a little bit more. So if anyone out there plays an instrument and wants to collaborate, I'd love to expand it.
And before we actually listen to Lullaby in its entirety, did it actually help you to memorize more digits than you thought you might?
I think it did. And it's actually a trick I use now. We were driving around the city the other day, my partner and I, and we saw a telephone number that we wanted to remember. And I immediately started kind of mapping it onto the tones. And I found I could remember it 5 days later just by creating a simple little song.
Maybe I'll do that with my kids' school schedule. I'll start singing it from now on.
Yeah, it'll make you the coolest dad in school, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. Singing in front of my kids, in front of their friends is totally going to make me cool. Well, I am really excited for us to be able to play this. This is the, can we say it's the world premiere of Lullaby?
This is the world premiere, yes.
Here it is. In its entirety, all 3 minutes and 14 seconds. You just listened to Lullaby by Devin Powell. Again, thanks for joining us, Devin, and happy Pi Day.
Thanks, Jeff. Happy Pi Day.
Scientific American Science Quickly is produced by me, Jeff Delvisio, Talika Bose, and Kelso Harper. Our theme music is by Dominic Smith. Subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. And for more science news, go to scientificamerican.com.
It's Tom. Could we humbly suggest your donation to netrootsradio.com? All we've got to run this 24-hour powerhouse of progressive resistance radio is what comes out of our own wallets. And you are our biggest donor. It doesn't take much, $3, $5. Just go to the bottom of our netrootsradio.com page and hit our secure donate button. Heck, you can even make a recurring contribution. So donate what you'd like at the bottom of our netrootsradio.com's homepage. Because you are our biggest donor. Netrootsradio.com. Together, we are Resistance Radio.
Profiteering is always bad, but there are degrees of profiteers. Level 1 includes your everyday price gougers like banks and airlines. At level 2, you'll find the more demonic outfits like loan sharks and far-profit college hucksters. Then, top of the heap at level 3, you'll find Eli Lilly. This $288 billion drug-making colossus is America's primary peddler of insulin, the diabetes drug that some 7 million Americans must constantly take, literally to stay alive. But having both monopoly power over the market and such a huge base of captive customers, Lilly has gleefully jacked up its prices again and again over 3 decades, with it now costing each sufferer as much as $1,000 a month. Finally, under intense political pressure to stop its extreme life-threatening gouging, the giant recently announced it would cut its insulin prices by a whopping 70%. In full-page ads, Lilly hailed its corporate generosity, magnanimously declaring that, quote, everyone deserves affordable options. But, hello, it has intentionally charged unaffordable rip-off prices for 30 years, wallowing in monopoly profits. And hello again, if Lilly says it can keep profiteering on its insulin product despite slashing the price by 70%, that means it has been overcharging patients by 70% all this time. Yet its rich executives want us to thank them? No, thank you. Even with a price cut, they're still charging $66 for a single vial of insulin. Guess what? It costs Lilly less than $7 to produce that vial, and it could be sold profitably for under $9. Meanwhile, Lilly's price cut is voluntary, meaning it can raise the price again at any time. And CEO David Ricks has refused to pledge that he'll keep the medicine affordable.
Who is the only professional baseball player ever to have pitched 2 perfect games? And why don't we know that pitcher's name?
I'm Lily Ledbetter, and this is a Civil Liberties Minute with ACLU attorney Bill Newman.
The first answer is Gene Fout, who over an 8-year career won 140 games and had an amazing minuscule earned run average of 1.23 for the South Bend, Indiana Blue Sox. The second answer, because the South Bend Blue Sox were a women's team, part of the All-American Girls Professional Baseball League, which was portrayed in the 1992 film A League of Their Own. Fout pitched her first perfect game against the Rockville, Illinois Peaches in 1951, and her second 2 years later against the Kalamazoo Lassies. She was a natural athlete who in high school played field hockey and basketball and ran track. She also pitched batting practice for the Greenville Cubs, a men's semi-pro team that practiced on a field near her home in Pennsylvania. And for the Blue Sox, when she wasn't pitching, she played third base or the outfield. Gene Fout died on February 28th at the age of 98. The headline of the New York Times obituary read, Gene Fout, a professional pitcher who was in a league of her own. We take this moment to remember Gene Fout and to thank her and the other players of the AAG PBL for indeed being in a league of their own.
The Civil Liberties Minute is made possible by the ACLU because freedom can't protect itself.
I'm Rick Smith, and this is Labor History in 2. On this day in labor history, the year was 1912. That was the day that participants in the famed Bread and Roses strike gathered in Lawrence, Massachusetts to celebrate their victory. The strike had begun in January and was a hard-fought battle. More than 20,000 textile workers, most of them women, speaking more than 20 languages, participated in the action. It was a powerful stand of workers' solidarity across ethnic lines. On March 12th, the American Woolen Company agreed to most of the strikers' demands. In the days that followed, other companies also agreed to terms. The workers gained between 5 and 25% raises depending on their jobs. They also gained overtime pay. The ripples of this impact flowed throughout New England. It's estimated that 150,000 textile workers saw raises in the aftermath of the historic work action. At the gathering to commemorate the strike, leader of the Industrial Workers of the World, Big Bill Haywood, addressed the crowd saying, "You are the heart and soul of the working class. You, the strikers of Lawrence, have won the most signal victory of any organized body of working men in the world. You have demonstrated that there is a common interest in the working class that can bring all its members together." Despite the significance of this strike, the story is not taught in many of our schools. In 2011, the Zinn Education Project found that only 2 of the 10 major U.S. history textbooks discussed the strike. Today, let's take a minute to remember those brave women who declared, "Yes, it's bread we fight for, but we fight for roses too." For more information, go to laborhistoryin2.com, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter at laborhistoryin2.
You for accompanying us here to the chef's table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, Tarrytown Chowder Tuesdays. We always begin weather from around the world along the banks of the Rogue River and the Rogue River Valley of Southern Oregon on the west coast of the continental United States of America, where it is currently 38 degrees Fahrenheit, expecting a high of only around 43. We are under quite a rain shower at the moment, which will be continuing throughout the day. Winds out of the northwest at 5 to 10 miles per hour, and rainfall is expected to be around 3/4 of an inch. Cloudy skies early tonight, then partly cloudy after midnight with lows in the low 30s. Winds light and variable, and then sun and a few passing clouds tomorrow with highs in the low to mid 50s. What? Well, we're looking forward to that. Winds will be light and variable as well. And then looks like we might have, that few passing clouds and sun tomorrow, and then picking up with more rain tomorrow night. Pollen is still rated as none here in the town of Rogue River. The air quality index for the region is in the good range at 24 parts per million, and the daytime UV index is moderate at level 2. Barometric pressure is falling at 29.7 inches, visibility is at 6 miles, and relative humidity is at 99%. Weather from around the world is brought to you by a crowd of crowdsourced weather stations that a crowd crowdsources from around the world. London is 48 degrees and cloudy. Paris is 47 and mostly cloudy. Rome is 60 degrees and mostly cloudy. Kyiv is 52 degrees and mostly cloudy. Kabul is 55 and partly cloudy. Hong Kong is 67 and fair. Tokyo is 50 degrees and partly cloudy. Sydney, Australia is 68 degrees and partly cloudy. San Francisco, California is 55 degrees with rain and wind and a small craft advisory on the bay and offshore. And New York is 30 degrees Fahrenheit with snow showers. And that is weather from around the world, brought to you by a crowd of crowdsourced weather stations that a crowd crowdsources from around the world.
We'll be right back.
Press brings us this first amuse-bouche here at the Chef's Table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Volkswagen announced yesterday, Monday, it plans to build a major plant for electric vehicle batteries in Canada, not the United States, in Canada. The European automaker said the Volkswagen Group and its battery company, PowerCo, will establish its first overseas gigafactory for battery cell manufacturing in St. Thomas in southwestern Ontario. The start of production is planned for 2027. The company signed an agreement last year with the Canadian government to work to identify suitable sites for such a facility in Canada. It also had committed to investigate ways for Canada to contribute to Volkswagen's battery supply chains, including raw materials and assembly. St. Thomas Mayor Joe Preston said it will be the largest automotive industrial complex in Canada's history. Ontario Economic Development Minister Vic Fedeli said Canada has gone from being behind the pack in the EV manufacturing sector to being one of the top players in the battery supply chain remarkably quickly. It is a stunning move, and I think acknowledged by Volkswagen that they felt that they would want to be in the middle of this whole electric battery ecosystem that we've created in Ontario, Fedeli said. Numbers, such as the money being invested and jobs being created, will be disclosed at a future announcement with Volkswagen representatives, Fedeli said. The company said Canada offers ideal conditions, including a local supply of raw materials and wide access to clean electricity. The province of Ontario set the stage last month for the announcement, introducing and quickly passing a law adjusting the municipal boundaries for a 1,500-acre megasite in southwestern Ontario. Fedeli said at the time that the piece of land had straddled two municipalities, but that it was being fit into one to eliminate bureaucratic challenges of dealing with two municipalities. Canada has seen at least 10 major electric vehicle-related commitments totaling more than $12 billion U.S. in the past 2 years as federal and provincial governments work to attract investments to the sector.
Je te donne ce mon amour pour la vie entière, la promesse de me trouver à tes genoux. Aussitôt que tu m'appelles, rester toujours fidèle, c'est tout, c'est tout. Je te donne tous mes printemps, mes étés de mai, mes automnes. Quand les feuilles tombent partout, si ce n'est pas une bonne affaire, je te donne tous mes hivers.
Fatima Hussein of the Associated Press brings us this final amuse-bouche here at the Chef's Table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. The U.S. has begun an aggressive new push to inflict pain on Russia's economy and specifically its oligarchs with the intent of thwarting the Kremlin's invasion of Ukraine. From the Treasury Department to the Justice Department, U.S. officials will focus on efforts to legally liquidate the property of Russian oligarchs, expand financial penalties on those who facilitate the evasion of sanctions, and close loopholes in the law that allow oligarchs to use shell companies to move through the U.S. financial system. Andrew Adams, who heads the U.S. government's Klepto Capture Task Force, designed to enforce the economic restrictions within the U.S. imposed on Russia and its billionaires, told the Associated Press that the group is prioritizing its efforts to identify those who help Russians evade sanctions and violate export controls. These illicit procurement networks will continue to take up an ever-increasing amount of our bandwidth, said Adams, who also serves as acting Deputy Assistant Attorney General. So far, more than $58 billion worth of sanctioned Russian assets have been blocked or frozen worldwide, according to a report last week from the Treasury Department. The U.S. has begun attempts to punish the associates of wealth managers of oligarchs. A February study led by Dartmouth University researchers showed that targeting a few key wealth managers would cause far greater damage to Russia than sanctioning oligarchs individually. Other attempts to inflict pain on the Russian economy will come from the efforts to liquidate yachts and other property owned by Russian oligarchs and the Kremlin, turning them into cash to benefit Ukraine. Just don't tell the Republicans. And that brings us to the end of our broadcast period for the day. But you do know Netroots Radio broadcasts on, and we will meet up here tomorrow for Smothered Benedict Wednesdays. So do stay tuned to Netroots Radio all day and all night for all the breaking news as it breaks. And we will meet up here tomorrow, right here, in West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bon appétit.
Je voudrais du soleil vert, des dentelles et des théières, des photos de bord de mer, dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je voudrais de la lumière, comme en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Je veux changer d'atmosphère, dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je voudrais du Fred Astaire, revoir un latte coeur. Je voudrais toujours te plaire dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je veux déjeuner par terre comme au long de golfe clair, t'embrasser les yeux ouverts dans mon jardin d'hiver. Dans mon jardin d'hiver.